Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Developing My Will to Love group and is part of the Education in Love series. In the Understanding My Will presentation, Jesus helps us understand what our will is, where our will comes from, what influences our will versus willpower, and how negative and positive changes to our soul-based will occur. Recorded on the 26th of February 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
All right, well, our discussion now will focus on engaging our will to love and change. So in other words, like up until now, we remember the first two sessions, we were focused on sort of analysing our resistance to the process, and then we were looking at like facing that resistance, feeling about that resistance to through the process of engaging our will. Now what we want to do is focus a lot more attention on the actual process of fully engaging my personal will properly so that we can change and become loving. So the first part of this this series of discussions now is this section of understanding our will. So that's going to be our focus of attention for the next 2 hours. How do we go about understanding our will more fully? The first thing we'd like to say is that your will is not necessarily God's gift of free will. And we'll explain how that is the case. The gift of free will is a gift that God gave to you and gave to every single soul that he's ever created. So this is a gift that God gave without your asking for it or even desiring it. Right? Now, some of you probably want to give it back, but you can't. Okay, so this is a gift. But the development of my will is something a little different in the sense that it comes from within myself to develop. I must take action to develop it. Now, when we're first conceived, we probably don't, at that point, we are definitely not conscious of our own will, right? So before we even arrived on Earth, we, in our first incarnation, we were definitely not conscious of our own will. We didn't even know we had the gift of free will. And when we were conceived, we didn't know at that point either that we had the gift of free will. Right? The gift was given, but we had no awareness, intellectually or emotionally, at the time of conception, that this gift had been given. The difference between these two points that I'm trying to make is that my will is something to do with my developmental process of becoming aware of the fact that this gift has actually been given to me and I have the choice to develop it. Does that make sense? So while the gift has been given, right, and at the time of conception, we all have this gift given, or in fact, it's been given even before then. We were not able to know that it had been given until we went through the process of incarnation. And the incarnation process now attaches a physical and spiritual body to the soul, or to the half of the soul, and the reason why it does such a thing is so that it enables the development of our will, so that we can become aware that we have a will that we can develop. It's one of the primary reasons why we have this earth-based experience and also the spirit world-based experience, right? So that we can become aware that this gift of free will has been given to us and that we have a choice of how we can use it. Does that make sense to everyone? So Diana, you want to ask?
Yeah, there's aspects not making sense to me.
Mm-hmm.
So we've got a will And there's the gift of using it freely. Is that?
No, God gave us this gift because God wanted to create free sentient beings. So he wanted to create beings who weren't robotic, who had the choice to do things. He wanted that choice to be determined by your own desires and passions and longings. He wanted you to learn how to use this gift of choice that you have. Does that make sense? So the gift of choice is the gift of free will, right? But how you learn to use it is all up to you.
Thank you. What you choose to do.
Now, when I say it's all up to you, it's not entirely true either, because some of it has also been up to your parents before you, right? And in fact, between the process of conception and birth, right, you have actually had an impact already of how others have used their free will in your life. Does that make sense? And this is one of the things we need to understand about free will, is that our will does impact others, right? And this is a key thing that parents in particular need to learn, that the exercise of their will has a deep impact upon the next generation of people and what they choose to do. You follow? You know, it's all right, ask the questions.
So is that like a quality of free will? That.
You could say free will is the gift that God gave us all, and the quality of will is our exercise and development of the gift that God has given. And it can be exercised positively or negatively. And when I say positively, it can be exercised in harmony with love and truth, or negatively, it can be exercised out of harmony with love and truth. We have the choice, which is the gift itself, to make the choice of how we are going to exercise this will. Does that make sense?
Yep.
So one is the gift, free will, and the other is what we personally do with it. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So everyone's given the gift, but what you personally do with it is going to have a great effect, not only on your life, but on the lives of everyone around you, right? And this is something we need to come to understand. Yeah. So can you see, there's the gift of love, which is something you have to ask for, but there's the gift of free will that you haven't had to ask for. You've just got it, and it's really up to you how you use it. You can use it in harmony with love and truth, or you can use it out of harmony with love and truth. And there will be different kinds of effects as a result of the choices you make in that place. Make sense so far? Okay. Is there any questions there, Will? Maybe I should say William, just to not convince.
So, AJ, when we're projecting stuff at other people, that's an attempt, that's us using our will to attempt to influence the will of another person?
Correct. That's spot on. So, using our will to influence the will of others. And we frequently are attempting to influence the will of others, frequently, in our life. And there are many motivations we have for doing so, some of which are positive and others of which are negative. So, for example, my motivation for having this seminar with you was to influence your will, right? But in a positive direction, in harmony with love and truth, right? Yeah. If you go to a party and there's drugs and alcohol and other things there, then a lot of times it's a heap of spirits influencing your will, so that they can engage their process of what they want from that particular experience. And a lot of the people around are trying to avoid emotions and other things, so that's them influencing your will to do the same. And are you engaging your will, sharing in that experience? So, Alan?
Around about 2002, there was a series of books that came out on the earth about the use of your will.
Yeah.
Are you familiar with those books?
No.
Okay. Yep. Well,
what was their source?
Do you remember what their source was? No. Well, it was spirits.
Yeah. Okay.
Natural love spirits.
Yeah.
There were seven books, and each one was on the rainbow colours. And as you got to gold,
yeah,
then you were using your will the most lovingly.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So what my question is that in the spirit world, in the lower to higher spheres before the seventh sphere, is there much knowledge and teaching about the use of the will?
Of course there is.
Right, okay.
Yeah,
right.
This is a natural love. It's a natural love, part of your development of natural love.
Yeah. I get it more now than I got it when I was reading those books.
Yeah.
I feel I had a lot of resistance.
Yep.
What I notice is the repetition of what they talked about in exercising your will in a loving way.
Mm-hmm.
And that's and what I found interesting on each book you read, the repetition got more and more. So it was like a mantra as you got to the...
yeah. The only problem, though, with that is that it would have been their definition of love.
That's right, yeah.
And this is where, like, people can say these words to you, but at the end of the day, if it's not God's definition of love, then exercising your will in a loving way becomes unloving.
Because
it's not God's definition.
Yeah, the people that were... This isn't... It was a judgment back then, but not so much now. But the people who were distributing the books, who were trying to teach it in their workshops after studying it for years, felt that they were in a higher condition and they were getting it directly from source.
Yep.
And I that's when I lost it. I couldn't find out how they had changed or what they'd done. It was just got confusing.
Yeah, a person who's truly developing their will in a loving place, you will easily see the changes they're making in their day-to-day life. Easily.
Yep.
Yep. You'll notice it. It's so noticeable because none of the world generally are doing it. So it's really noticeable. You really notice a person who's trying to live and who does work through will-based issues to live in harmony with a loving will. Yeah. All right. So the question then becomes, how do I change my will? How do I, you know, develop my will, change it? Well, sometimes it can be just as simple as making a decision. Just that simple, making a different decision. Isn't that wonderful? Like with some things, and in particular, can I clarify what those things will be? If you don't have any emotional preclusion inside of your soul to act in a certain manner in harmony with love, then it's highly likely you will act in harmony with love. If there's nothing inside of your soul that tells you to act out of harmony with love, it's highly likely you'll be drawn to acting in harmony with love. Right, and there's also many situations and circumstances where we feel impelled to act in harmony with love, even though on our average day-to-day life we don't feel impelled. Things like natural disasters, when they occur, many people become quite loving, don't they? So they feel impelled under the natural disaster issue because they feel the imperative of, oh, okay, that's what it's like to lose everything. It's a terrible feeling to lose everything. I want to help that person because I've lost everything. And now they're acting in harmony with love in that particular situation, right? However, the converse is also true, that if we're not getting addictions met, it's highly unlikely we will act in harmony with love. Which is a sad fact too. In fact, it's highly likely we will act terribly when we're getting our addictions met, when we desire for our addictions to be met. Because our addictions, which are emotional, drive our actions and therefore drive how we exercise our will and make our choices. So on one hand, changing your will can be really, really simple. Could be possibly simple, but on the other, if I've got a whole heap of emotions and a whole heap of other experiences that are negative that I've not released from the past, and I've got a whole heap of fear and a whole heap of addictions and a whole heap of desire to maintain a facade, then of course changing your will can be very complicated, very complex. It's difficult. This is why many people don't do it. Lorleen, thanks.
With children, especially when they're developing their will, It is so crucial then how they are guided then, I suppose.
Very crucial, yeah. This is why if parents have not learned how to exercise their will before they have children, then it's highly unlikely the child is going to understand this beautiful gift and therefore they will grow up without any real understanding of the gift. And so what do? They then engage their will negatively as well with the next generation and so forth. So positive changes in your will affect the next generation of people. Negative changes in your will affect the next generation of people.
So when they're learning to, like, watching them decide to be rebellious and I will, I won't, and a no comes out, no, 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 is that learning the will, how powerful it is, and then our reaction to that is going to?
Yeah, but what's the average adult's reaction to it?
They don't like the no.
It's not in an action of teaching the child to use their will, is it? It's usually we take an action where we get angry with them, which is basically teaching them that if they have their will that someone's going to get angry with them, which is not teaching them something positive about their will at all. And also we resist having consequences. So we resist as adults, generally parents resist imposing consequences upon their children. And when you resist imposing consequences, the child then believes there's no consequence. And that's not helping them understand that if you use your will out of harmony with love, there will be a negative consequence. Or if you use your will in harmony with love, there will be a positive consequence. It's not helping them to understand those basic principles. So oftentimes parents are in direct disagreement with God's principles and therefore teach the child direct disagreement with God's principles. And so the child grows to be an adult who then completely disagrees with the underlying principles of how your will can be engaged. And that's why we have pain and suffering. Because as adults now, we believe that if we engage our will this way, that we should get, you know, happiness from the world. But unfortunately, happiness from the world usually, in most cases, means that there's going to be some negative consequence from one of God's laws and vice versa. And this is the problem with how we teach our children. But let's discuss more before we ask more questions, because there's a lot more to understand. And then we'll probably be able to flesh out how it all works positively. So the other thing we need to understand that is, of course, and we've talked to you about this many times, that there is a separation here between your mind and your soul. In other words, the will is exercised at the soul level. It's not what you think you feel, it's what you actually feel. It's what many people refer to as their subconscious, isn't it? Right? In other words, they think, I really want to do this good thing, but I keep being impelled to do this bad thing. Right? Not understanding that actually the soul-based will is wanting you to do the bad thing in that particular situation. And it's only your mind that wants you to do the good thing at this particular stage, right? Now, let's define good and bad. Good being in harmony with love and truth, bad being out of harmony with love and truth. We, of course, then have a lot of judgment of good and bad, don't we? And with shame and all these other emotions, but they are just emotions. Let's just look at it as it really is. Good being in harmony with love and truth, bad being out of harmony with love and truth. So most people believe in the subconscious as a result. And they believe that the subconscious is something that has to be overcome. Right? And this then turns into religious belief systems. In the Bible, there's a statement that says, the heart is treacherous. Who can know it? Basically, what that statement is saying is that you can't know your own soul's true passions and desires, and often those passions and desires will mislead you, right? And then they're often called things like animal instincts. They will drive you into doing a whole heap of things that even intellectually you don't want to even potentially do, right? And this is a misunderstanding of how we are made. Because if we understood how we were made, we understand that the soul has its will And that will drives our actions, our words, our speech. It drives everything. It drives oftentimes our development. It drives how what we learn about, even. Many of those things are all driven by the exercise of our will. And what I'm saying to you is your will does not have to be determined by the common viewpoint of how to exercise your will, which unfortunately is how most of us use our will. Our will is determined, really, in most cases, by popular opinion. How we exercise our will is generally determined by popular opinion. It doesn't have to be, but also our will becomes, these popular opinions, as we call them, become emotional beliefs, don't they? They are emotions or belief systems that exist within our soul. And now the soul will drive the mind and drive our speech and drive our actions and so forth. So can you see, to truly change your will, you're going to have to learn to change your soul rather than change what you intellectually decide. So it's a key thing to understand. So the question then becomes, well, what is the soul sort of influenced by? What influences this soul? So let's just center everything now around the soul. I'll just get rid of these things. So how does this soul's will get influenced? What do you think? Thanks, Nina.
Well, it gets influenced by many things, which could probably be broken down into error and truth.
Okay, yes, we can break them down into error and truth. Let's define error. What's error?
Anything out of harmony with God's truth or love.
Correct. So this is all out of harmony with truth and love. All right, and you said truth was the other influence.
And the truth would be God's truth.
Yeah, so we're talking now everything that's in harmony, aren't we? With God's love or truth and truth. Okay, so there are the influences. Now you've seen that diagram many times, haven't you? Yeah, like it's one of the first things that we presented, even in the Secrets of the Universe, the two types of influences. Okay, so you've seen it lots and lots of times, but let's be more specific, shall we? So for example, let's look at error in terms of a granular way, what kinds of error are going to enter what type of error is going to enter the soul. Well, let's say I want to influence you somehow. What's one way I can influence you? I use my language to do what to you? So Bruce, just
manipulate or control, or
yeah, or to, you could say, just drop a thought into your mind,
yeah.
Right? So
influence.
So you could say, and maybe I'll just use a different colour here now, just say, right, so thoughts could be beliefs, my beliefs. I can just talk about my beliefs, my beliefs with you, couldn't I? And drop those into your mind. Right? So even me just talking to you influences your will in some way, right? And that, by the way, applies to every single person who ever talks to you, right? They are influencing your will in some way, right? Whether they even know it or not, in many cases, they're influencing your will. Like when they say, oh, did you see that event overseas where this particular thing happened? Bang, they're influencing your will. Without you even realizing, right? Now, most of us, I feel, don't realize that even every conversation we have is somehow influencing our will, right? Every single thing you read influences your will. Every belief that's ever expressed to you influences your will. So why are we so terrified of somebody influencing our will? Like, it's happening every day, isn't it? And to be honest, if we truly understood how to use our will, would we really be very afraid about how others influence our will? We wouldn't, would we? So, you know, when somebody says, like, what happened a lot of the times when, you know, when I started teaching was people would say, oh, you're all just taking the Kool-Aid, right? So that's an influence of your will, isn't it? Don't listen because what happened in, I forget where it was, somewhere in the US. It wasn't Waco, it was Jonestown or whatever it was, yeah, where hundreds of people were encouraged to suicide. That's going to happen to you if you listen to this guy, right? There's an influence of your will. Now, a lot of people listened to that. And so they didn't decide to do any further listening of divine truth as a result. A lot of people listen to those kind of things. When the media says to you, oh, he's just this or he's just that, or this person's this or this person's that, what are they doing? They're influencing your will. Now, if your will is so easily influenced in the sense that you're not got a pretty firm idea about where you want to go, what you want to do in your life, you're just going to be pushed around a fair bit like this, aren't you? Back and forward, all over the joint, right? Right? And the reality is, this is what happens to many of you, you're just as easily influenced by a negative spirit as you are a positive one. Right? You need to change that. You want to be only influenced by positive spirits and never be influenced by negative ones. That would be better, wouldn't it? But I notice also in your day-to-day interaction, you're influenced just as much by a person who's a nasty individual who just wants to attack you as you are a nice individual who just wants to love you. You're often influenced just the same amount. This is a big problem, right? If you're ever going to have an education in love and you're ever going to develop in love and you're ever going to use your will to be in harmony with love, one of the things you've got to learn is to not listen to people who are trying to influence your will in another direction. And you've got to learn how to identify them. And you can't. Most of you can't. You know, someone's talking to you and you can't feel their feeling coming towards you. You're hearing the conversation without feeling the feeling. So you're not understanding how you're being influenced in that conversation, even with the feelings coming from you. So that brings me another thing that can influence you. Feelings. Other people's or your own negative ones can influence your will, can't they? Feelings, you could say feelings and emotions. Aspirations and intentions can influence your will. So the intention of another person can influence your will. So somebody comes and knocks on your door and says, look, I'm going down the street, you want to come? That's influenced your will. Just quite simple. Because the intention, they have the intention to go down the street. Right? They're asking you if you want to come. If they hadn't have done that, you might not have thought of going down the street. The fact that they had asked you now means that you're now thinking about it and you're now having to make a decision. So they've influenced your will, haven't they? Just by expressing their intention to you, they've influenced your will. So can you see intentions of others and obviously your own intentions can affect others? Intentions. How do I spell it? I-N-T-I-O-N. Intentions. You could say things like there's inspiration and there's aspiration, right? Those two things can also influence your will. Now, what do I mean by inspiration? Well, inspiration to me is when somebody else inspires you to do something. It comes from somebody else's feelings that they inspire you. That's what I'm trying to do today, isn't it? Inspire you. So, you know, that certainly can influence your will. So you could say inspiration can certainly influence your will. Now, many of you are inspired to do very many negative things by spirits who surround you and by other people. You're inspired by what they're saying. So, you know, do you want to have a cup of coffee? Would you like to come down and just have a barbecue, out for a barbecue? And we're having meat, you know. So there's some inspiration received from another person. What are you going to do? Right? Aspiration, it comes from within oneself. Aspiration. So when I'm saying that, I'm saying that my aspiration can become your inspiration. Right? And my aspiration to do something, well, whatever that be, whether it be good or evil, whether it be good or bad, whether it be out of harmony with love or in harmony with love, can influence your aspiration. Your inspires you to do one or the other things as well. Even my negative aspiration, you can actually receive as a positive inspiration. So in other words, I have an aspiration to harm somebody, I go out and harm somebody, and then a whole heap of negative things occur in my life as a result of that harm, and you go, there's good inspiration to not do that. You follow? So even somebody being negative and demonstrating their unloving behaviour can actually inspire you to be loving. Right? Isn't that what war could do? Sure, you know, all someone has to do is walk through a war-torn country and smell the dead and feel what's happened in terms of the pain and suffering. Surely that'd be almost inspiration enough, wouldn't it, for the average person who's sensitive emotionally to say, we've got to stop war altogether. And yet it's not. But it could be. Could be inspiration enough, yeah. Right up the back, Elvira.
Where you said if somebody knocks on the door and asks you, do you want to do something, you've got it listed on the out of harmony.
Oh, no, I'm listing these as all, this list here is all belongs in both lists, of course. It's interchangeable, isn't it? So it also belongs here.
Yep. So it's not always negative.
No, it could be positive. Yeah,
because I get confused.
Somebody could say, come down the street, and it would be a real positive influence of your will, because when you went down the street, you found something you've been looking for years and you haven't ever found it before, and this was a great... And if it wasn't for them saying, come down the street with me, you'd never know.
My big problem with those situations is that, which I get into with my husband a lot, as soon as he wants something...
Can we stop personalising these questions? You have a bad habit of doing this,
Elvira. Yeah,
okay. Let's look at the theories first, and then we'll have a look at the personal issues. If we come to Fabio, Dan.
Well, that, I mean, your desires can get influenced. The same thing, isn't it?
Of course. So desires. So we're extending this list. It's not, this list now applies to both columns, doesn't it? Desires. Even my actions can influence you, can I not?
Yeah.
Yeah. My actions have influenced you, actually. Right, like I decided I wanted to do a seminar and you decided you're going to come. So my actions influence your decision. Right? What surprises me is the majority of people on the earth, because of childhood issues, are so afraid of being influenced. Honestly, we're terrified of it. And yet we're influenced every day. Influenced every single day, every single moment of every single day, we're influenced by something, right? It's how, and this all affects how what your soul finishes up choosing, does it not? This does affect it. Anything else you can think of? Bruce, thanks.
And would laws and things like that fit in there? You know, that you're influenced by laws and, you know. What you can and can't do according to the
Yes, world. But by, you could say we're influenced by society and human law. Like, I know many people who would murder a person at a drop of a hat, but because there's a law that says you can't, they won't. Right? So even things like penalties can influence a person, but not... can influence a person either in their soul or with regard to their choices and decisions, can they not? penalties and rewards. You're influenced by rewards a lot, right? You go down the shop, says, 2 for 1. What are you going to do? You want one of them, so you think two of them is better than one, so I'm always going to go for the 2 for 1. Do you follow me if I want the thing? Many of you then go, you know, this offer will not be repeated. Yeah, sure, right? But the reality is we're influenced by that, aren't we? Because we're so afraid of missing out, right? So we're influenced by that. We're influenced all the time, all the time. Suzanne.
Education.
Yes, which are the thoughts and beliefs and feelings of others imposed upon us. But definitely education all fits in amongst all of these things, I feel. Okay. Raj?
Past experiences.
We are, yes, certainly influenced by past experiences. Yep. To me, they're just emotions that are stored within us that we then act upon. Yep. Lorleen?
Would prayer come under emotions and aspirations and things?
Well, yeah, I feel prayer is your aspiration. So sort of comes under that. Your desire and aspiration is prayer. So that certainly can influence you. Yeah. I think you've got the idea, haven't you? Yeah. That pretty much anything influences you. Right. And it's not a bad thing, right? Is it? Whether it's good or bad depends upon what? Well, whether it's in harmony or out of harmony with love. Right? But what does human love say? Human love says it's okay to influence somebody as long as you're influencing them in a good way, and to even not tell them and not inform them that you're influencing them as long as you're doing it in a good way. In other words, you're making a choice or decision for others. Many of you do that all the time. You make choices and decisions for other people. That is not in harmony with love. Because the loving thing to do is to always inform a person of the choice they're allowed to make. Does that make sense? To allow them to make an informed choice, it would make sense that, you know, you would inform a person. So for example, you see this a lot in relationships where one person accidentally kissed somebody outside of the relationship. I don't know if it's such an accident, but anyway. And so what do? They say, I can't tell my partner because it will hurt them. Now, then they make it, so their emotion drives their own will to not take a truthful action. Of course, we're now in error zone because it's out of harmony with love. But what we do is we withhold the information under those circumstances towards our partner. Well, not only have we taken an error-based action based on fear as well, but also we have influenced their will by not disclosing the truth. We have actually influenced their will. So you can actually withhold truth from somebody and influence their will, right? Which is not the same as lying to them and influencing their will, is it? Or is it? Isn't it the same effect? Yeah. So you can see that withholding truth from people, from God's perspective, is really just lying to people. Okay. Agree. Thanks.
And I noticed that sometimes we are fantasizing or about other, and then we say as an excuse that, oh, this is has a positive influence, so, but in fact is an addiction, so we are quite damaging.
Yes. So in other words, we do things like in relationships, is again something we do frequently, is we feel, you know, they are attractive, or this person's attractive and that person's attractive and so forth. And why we feel that is a whole heap of emotional reasons why that's the case, usually addictions. And then we also then say to ourselves, well, you know, this is good because it gets me stirred up at home, you know, so that's how I get my... You know, that's so the whole concept, you know, it doesn't matter where you, what's the saying in Australia? Doesn't matter where you get your appetite as long as you eat at home. Yeah. Not very nice. But again, a lot of people believe it, right? But that we're digressing a bit. So we can see here the influences upon your will. Yep, Raj, you might have a question about it?
The question is, so does the soul have a propensity one way or the other when it starts out the journey, or does it all depend on the influences that it's getting as to which way it goes?
At the time of conception, no, it doesn't have a propensity either way. That's why it's an open book. It can receive anything from its parents. And this is the critical part of being a parent. Just by becoming pregnant, you are now influencing the will of another person. And now their will is going to determine what you have not understood about will. So if you haven't understood a large deal about will, and so you've engaged your will negatively and out of harmony with love many times, these emotions are stored within you as a result, then of course from the time of conception, particularly until the time the child is out of your control, and most of us feel it's out of our control, not, you know, that's how we view children, we have a tendency then, all through that time as a parent, we're now influencing the will of another. Now, if that is out of harmony with love, there are, like, consequential, from God's perspective, there's consequences if it's out of harmony with love. And unfortunately for the majority of us, we've influenced our children out of harmony with love, right? This is why the imperative is for us to address these issues, because from the time of conception to a couple of years of age in particular, the child is already being influenced, has already had their will influenced out of harmony with love, and it's been our fault. Which will, of course, be attributed to us.
So then every subsequent interaction with any of these things is going to be slanted towards
error. It's going to be slanted to the world's definition of love, isn't it? So remember the world's definition a lot of the times, not all the time. So the world's definition is of love is frequently on this side of the equation, isn't it? Right? Frequently on that side of the equation. So naturally, if the world's definition of love is something I've imbibed and then I have a child, then of course my child now is absorbing the world's definition of love before it even has a chance to exercise or discover its will.
And it's reinforced continuously by the world's delivery of...
Exactly, after it's born, it's reinforced. And this is what we meant in the Bible when we referred to the sin of the father being passed on to the son for generation after generation. Now that's a Bible quote, I think Luke wrote it and a number of others. So, you know, this is the sin of the generation being passed on to the next generation. All right.
Thank you.
Now, the problem is that I've already spent 45 minutes talking about that, and there's some really important things we need to learn about will. So I'm going to skip the difference between will and willpower. You understand? Well, and it's all written down. Mary's already written down in this outline the difference between will and willpower. My suggestion is to really understand that well. I think you had it presented to you in 2014 where you understood the difference between those two things in that first day. And so my suggestion is go over that again, understand the difference between will and willpower. Will coming from the soul, willpower coming from the soul's avoidance of what's in the soul, desire to avoid what's in the soul. You follow me? Yep. So the soul who desires to avoid a whole lot of things that are in the soul will then start to use its willpower to avoid what it actually, its will is trying to determine. And what I'm suggesting to you is give that up, because it's very negative to your progress. You need to just be honest about what's in and then work through letting go of the reason why those particular things are inside of you. Yeah, so Sherry?
Just quickly, so willpower has a lot to do with our facade then?
Not just our facade. Our desire, it's not just our desire to maintain an image of ourselves that is completely incorrect, which obviously is our facade. But it's also often driven by external pressures, just like we've mentioned. Remember, every one of these things we've listed can be feelings inside of things inside of you, but also things inside of someone right next to you who's influencing you, and can be things inside society generally which are also influencing you. And we need to come to understand that pretty much anything can influence us. And it's how we make the choice of all this information. And remember, to me, information isn't just intellectual information. There's all this emotional information, beliefs, and all these other things coming at us all the time, right? And how we make the choice to use that information and select it for ourselves is going to greatly determine the outcome of how we exercise our personal will. You follow? Yep. Can I just proceed? So I just want to proceed with something that we need to talk about and while I've got the time. So most of us at this stage can see that, wow, pretty much everything influences our will somehow. And can I say, though, that it doesn't have to? In other words, it's your choice whether those things influence your will. Right? So other people's feelings, they don't have to influence your will. Even your own feelings don't have to influence your will. If you know they're out of harmony with love, you'd be better off choosing using your will to feel them rather than to act upon them. You see? So even your own feelings don't have to determine how you use your will. Because it determines, with your own feelings, you could choose to feel them and not act upon them. You could do that with your will. But to do that has to be a soul-based decision. It's not something you're going to be able to intellectually choose to do. And the way you're going to have to do that is by stop having these belief systems inside yourself that emotions are really bad and that we shouldn't feel emotion and so forth. So that's a will-based choice to work through some belief systems that have entered you that are false. And then coming out the other end of that, believing that actually it's right to work through my emotions. And then I'll start processing some emotion as a result of that. So everything that happens is coming from the exercise of our will. Everything that we choose to do is coming from the exercise of our will, or through our being easily influenced by the will of others. Now, the majority of us are far too easily influenced by the will of others. Honestly, many of you have already tried this where you've put up your hand and said, I've done this the other day, do you think that was a good idea? And what did I say to you? Now, if I say it's a good idea, what are you going to feel? If I say it's a bad idea, what are you going to feel? Would you have changed your action if I said it was a good idea or a bad idea? Right, probably. So therefore, you're easily influenced by your will. Is it a good idea or a bad idea? And you need to determine for yourself in your relationship with God, don't you? See, this is where it becomes imperative that you have this relationship with God, because God has pure motives when it comes to the influence of your will. You don't know the motivations of others, and a lot of times you can't even feel the motivations of others, so you won't know them. And it will only be when you feel the motivations of others that you will know them, right? But God is the person who's going to be able to influence your will the most positively. So it makes sense to understand that actually everything around me is influencing my will, and I need to be selective. I need to be selective. Can you see that? Okay. So let's look at the selectivity now of the exercise of our will. What are we going to do with the exercise of our will? How do we make positive changes with the exercise of our will? Well, it's quite simple. Remember the definition of sin? What's the definition of sin? So everything that's out of harmony with love or truth is a sin. And everything that's in harmony with love or truth, not a sin. Right? So the definition of sin, we understand the definition of sin. So all we need to do is remember this word, sin. Right? Soon as I do anything that actually validates sin in any way, that actually goes along with sin in any way, right, my will is going to be affected negatively. Or to put it more precisely, as Mary said it, acting in disharmony with God's love, God's truth, or God's laws causes destruction of love-based will. Now that's in your notes, so you don't need to write that down. So that was acting in harmony, disharmony with God's love, God's truth, or God's laws causes the destruction of a love-based will. Now think about that and go, gee whiz, I'm destroying a love-based will quite frequently, right? In my day-to-day actions, you know? And that's a problem. If it's like, how can I make progress while I'm actually taking actions to destroy the love-based will in the process? You obviously don't want to do that anymore. Right? So, if we go and think about thoughts, words, beliefs, actions that we had all written down on the board just before, right? And perhaps what I should have done is left it there and gone onto this board, but it's all done now. It's a choice I made. It's gone. and so, if we think about our thoughts, well, you can have thoughts that are sin, and spending your time thinking about those particular things is going to influence your love-based will. You can have feelings that are sin, and spending your time like acting upon those feelings is going to destroy your love-based will. Or believing those feelings or accepting them as true is going to destroy your love-based will. You can have desires, intentions. If they are sinful, they're out of harmony with love and truth, they will destroy your love-based will. Somebody else could have them, and they talk to you about them, and you listen to them. Now that's destroyed your love-based will. So what have we learned from that? That the world is geared towards destroying your love-based will. Because most of the time, the world's definition of love is out of harmony with love. So the world is geared towards destroying your love-based will. All right, so this is a problem, right? But that's how we develop our will negatively. So instead of writing that down, I'll just say here. Negative development of will, quite simple, choosing sin. So why, how do we develop our will positively? Isn't it pretty much the opposite of that? Yes, it is. So positive development of will don't sin. Now, of course, there's a lot more we need to say about that, but can you see the basic principle? It's pretty basic, isn't it? If we choose to do things or choose to think of things or choose to believe things or choose to act upon things or choose to remain in the feeling of things that are out of harmony with love and truth, then we're desiring sin. And if we desire sin, then our will is going to be headed down the track of being unloving and therefore not positive. The net consequence is going to be pain and suffering, and the outcome is going to be not very good for us. It's going to be very unhappy. That's what we're choosing to do. Robert?
So does that mean unless I engage a positive development of will, I'm automatically going to be doing the other one constantly? Because the sin's already in me and I'm just going to be acting...
Correct, and this is our problem. This is why we have a tendency to sin. The tendency to sin comes from the fact that we have a whole heap of emotions within us that are already predisposing us to sin, right? these emotions coming from our family of origin, our society and so forth, the world's definition of love being imposed upon us from the time of our first, you know, conception to onwards. And then, of course, also imposed by our subsequent choices, which are also based upon many of these unhealed emotional states. And so we then have a predisposition towards sinning. And that's why the Christian view is actually correct on that matter. There is a predisposition for sinning inside of the soul, but it's only because the previous sin of the previous generations hasn't been dealt with by the persons involved. And it can be dealt with. It can be released, right? So this is a problem. This is the problem, and what I feel is that demonstrates the importance of using your will, because it doesn't just affect you, right? And this is what I feel. Most people think they like. How often do you hear this basic underlying statement from the world? I'm not hurting anyone. Man, there's people who do not understand the exercise of their will when they say things like that, right? Because the reality is every choice, decision you make, every feeling you hold on to, everything you choose to do that's out of harmony with love and truth, every sin you engage does, even if you think it primarily just affects you, it does affect other people. It affects the children of the next generation as well. This is what we need to learn about will, that it doesn't just affect us. How we use our will doesn't just affect us. The hells of the spirit world are littered with people who believed their life wasn't harming other people. That's why they're in the hells, because they have a false belief that you can make a choice out of harmony of love and not harm somebody else. You can't. Yeah. Rachel, thanks.
So does that mean even if your intention is to love, but got lots of emotion about this one.
Yep.
My dad was, his intention was to love, but it was all fear-based beliefs that he was trying to put into me. And
yes, but see, that's his definition of love, which he refused to give up. His definition of love said to him he could impose fear upon his children. But you see, that's not God's definition of love. So in that process, he was sinning. So it doesn't matter that a person, like to my mind, if he was more open to connection with God, he would have known he was sinning. But because of his arrogance, he decided that no, the proper way of loving was to actually fear-based imposition of rules upon my children, right? But that's sin. That's why it's harmed you.
It doesn't even matter what the intention was.
Well, I would argue that his intention, if somebody imposes fear, even though they think their intention is good, it's bad. See, we're talking about whose definition of intention. You see, remember, everything's about God's definition of things, not yours. So whose definition of intention? God's is what matters. So when God looks at your intention, God's saying, did you intend to make your children afraid? And the answer your father would have to be, yes, I did intend to make them afraid, because I believed, false belief, that it's only by motivating people with fear that they do anything good. Which is not true, by the way. And this is one thing we need to learn about our will. We can be motivated to do good things even though we're not afraid. Right? Unfortunately, the world is not very easily motivated in that direction at this point. But this is the thing your father didn't understand about his intentions. His intention was to create fear.
Thanks.
For some reason. And a lot of times it's belief systems that he had that were false and so forth that cause an intention to create fear, because he believes that it's only fear that will motivate a person to do the right thing. And many of you believe that. that it's only fear that will motivate you to do the right thing. Many times, this is why you struggle with the progress on the divine love path, because God's not going to motivate you with fear. God's going to motivate you with love, right? But most of us don't even understand love, so we're only motivated by fear. So when someone threatens you, you do it. And someone doesn't threaten you, you don't do anything. That's an indication that you're motivated by fear rather than love, you see? We've noticed that a lot, even just with donations, right? If we don't do something, then people feel like, oh, we've got to keep doing something, so we'll donate something. But if we do something, most people then feel, oh, they're doing something now, so they don't need more donations. They must have enough. Right? So it's the same principle, isn't it? Just motivated by the negative. Most of us are. Most of us are. Sad, but that's the trouble with the world's definition of love, right? We're motivated by the negative and not motivated by the positive. Most of us don't even believe the positive is real anyway. So, of course, we're not going to be motivated by it. Wayne, you want to up the back? Thanks.
So if we develop our will to stop sinning, does that have an effect on the children that are already here?
Of course it does, but obviously there's going to be a conflict with them because they already have a will developed to sin. So, you know, that's in them that has to be helped to come out of them.
It would still help them, though.
It would help them, of course, because there's now a contrast between what it looks like to live in harmony with sin and what it looks like to live out of harmony with sin, right? What it looks like to live in harmony with love, you see. This is something we need to understand a lot more deeply because a majority of us sort of have very little understanding of the universal consequences of our behaviour. Is probably the best way of putting it. We just think that our behaviour or our, you know, our will is just ours and it's only going to affect us. And that's not the case at all. It's going to have global effect, universal effect. It has your will right now has a whole heap of effect on spirits, even the spirits in the hells. You don't realise that you're affecting them negatively. Can I explain why? Well, when you choose to feed a spirit's addiction, so let's say a spirit comes along and threatens you and says you should do this and you can feel the threat and so you go ahead and do what they want, you're actually feeding their addiction. When you feed somebody's addiction, you're sinning and you're harming them. So you say, oh, those spirits came and did this to me or they did that to me. And I say, well, you did that to them too. You see, that's what it means to be in a codependence with them. You do harmful things to others without realizing it. Every time an angry person comes up and threatens you and you go along with them, you're harming them. Can you see that? Because you're enabling their angry behavior and you're rewarding it. Every time your child kicks a tantrum and you give him a lolly, you're enabling him, aren't you? Isn't it? Why doesn't the same apply if they're an adult doing the same thing to you? Right? We often are taking action that's out of harmony with love, thinking or feeling that we're just preventing the negative behaviour of another, but preventing the negative behaviour of a person is actually out of harmony with love. Right? I can't restrict you from doing the wrong thing, can I? How do I do that without harming your exercise of your will? Right. So there's principles here, right? Now, obviously, collectively, societally, that's different. And it's also very different if you're in, you know, have children. You want to teach people, as a society, we want to teach people how to live in harmony with the loving use of will. So we establish laws that are based around the loving use of will. With a child, we want to do the same. We want to teach the child how to act in harmony with will. So what we do is we establish exactly the same kinds of laws that God's established to help that child. And therefore, we may restrict their exercise of will while we're teaching them to exercise will. You follow? So you could have a police force, right, still on the planet. If everybody understood the use of their will, I doubt whether you'd need them very much. But you could still have one during a transitional phase of getting people away from these concepts that they can go and do anything they want into the idea and concept that actually, no, everything has a consequence. And if we choose sin, we're developing our will negatively. That's going to have more negative consequences, not only on us, but also on the rest of society. So we obviously want to teach people that. We want to teach our children that. Can you see if I taught my child that, I wouldn't need a police force to teach an adult that, would I? If all of the children on the planet had learned this basic principle by the time they're 7 years of age, do you think by the time they're 16 or 17, they'd be wanting to murder, rape, pillage, drugs, whatever it else is that you're trying to prevent them to do? Of course not. They wouldn't want to. But for most of these children, they observe us as adults doing sinning, while at the same time denying the effects of our sin on them. And what do they learn through this hypocritical action of our own? At the end, they learn, well, the adults don't mean what they say. The adults don't believe what they're saying. Like, honestly, if I go to a school set with a bunch of seven-year-old kids, and I listen to them about what they think about bullying each other, or what they think about war, or what they think about, you know, eating meat even, the majority of them will probably tell me a whole heap of things far more in harmony with God's truth than their own parents would tell me. You're asking the same questions. All right. So that tells us that the next generation of children's primary influence is us not teaching them the truth, right? Yep. Okay. So, the long-term effect of choosing sin is self-destruction. The long-term truth about positive development of our will, not choosing sin, is perfection. That's how you become perfect, having no more sin. Right? Now, I'm talking about sin from God's perspective, so even a six-fear spirit under those definitions is not perfect. They might be perfected in natural love, but they still don't have God's definition. So therefore, they are still imperfect from God's perspective. Right? Okay. Well, perhaps what we need to do, I'm 10 minutes over, if we can just have a 10-minute break, and then we'll have a 50-minute Q&A where we might be able to sort of widen the scope of this discussion about understanding our will.